Hi, I'm John Atack, and I'm extraordinarily pleased to talk with Roger Nygaard. Hi, Roger.
Hello, good to see you again.
Yeah, it's been, about 12 years or something since last we met?
My film, The Nature of Existence, came out in 2010, and The Nature of Existence teaches people about religion and belief systems and how to be more aware by understanding them better. While you have a few laughs and enjoy the journey, this is why people believe what they believe. And then the truth about marriage is how to teach people how to be better consumers in relationships, how to be more aware of what's going on in a relationship, and why is everyone doing things... Everyone's doing their relationship wrong to some degree or another, some less wrong than others who have had more time through trial and error to figure things out. It always struck me as so odd that there's no class in high school to teach people how to have a relationship, which is arguably the most important thing you're going to have to do in your life, is to partner up with somebody for a quote, life partner. And they don't give you any goals or strategies or here are the pitfalls, here's how you can make it better. And there are things that you can do, very simple choices you can make that will directly affect the trajectory of any relationship you begin. And no one teaches you. You have to go out there and fall on your face over and over again. And that's why we have this entire industry of counselors and therapists to help us guide us through this minefield that's we're set up to fail within. And that's what I set out to understand better. And so the first half of The Truth About Marriage is more or less, here's all the problems. And the second half is, well, here's what you can do about it by making this little change in your life. For example, conflict is a big thing. Everyone has conflict with their partner when you disagree about who should take out the garbage or where you're going on vacation or how late someone can stay up. The way you deal with conflict is crucial to whether the relationship will survive and how happy you will be. And one of the things is to, if you have a disagreement about the garage is too messy, you should set an appointment to discuss it. Don't ambush somebody. In the moment, you should say, honey, I need to talk to you about the garage. Is tomorrow at noon a good time? No, that's not a good time. Okay, how about at 8 o'clock? Or no. Okay, how about Thursday at 7? Okay, fine. Now you've got a time, a date to discuss the garage. You write it down on a piece of paper, put it on the refrigerator or somewhere. That makes it real. It's tangible. It's an appointment. It's not, if you just say it and don't write it down, it could be, oh, I forgot. And it's it can be ignored. It's more easily ignored. Now you have time to sort of mentally prepare and think about it and cool down and discuss it rationally from both sides. Men have the most difficulty often with ambush discussions because their brains don't have as much wiring to deal with the emotional circuits. And so they're at a great disadvantage. And so they get to what John Gottman calls flooding, where the brain floods, and then it turns to anger. That comes more rapidly, and then conflict turns into arguments generally much more quickly when you don't set it up that way. And when you're in that moment of conflict, another good rule of thumb is remove the word you and replace it with I. Instead of saying, you are a slob, change it to, I feel anxious when the garage is a mess. Can you please help me to feel better? You're much more likely to get some kind of response, a positive response, to what you're requesting if you don't put your partner on the defensive. You're always so messy. You never do this. You never do that. It becomes a litany of crimes against the other person, and you're very unlikely to get a good response. I feel anxious, and I need help. That's going to get a better response. So there are things like that. If you just become aware of these basic things, you'll have a much happier and more relationship and much more longevity in your relationship. Those are some of the things I discovered.
And it's, you know, I was going to mention John Gottman too, because he is the guru in this area.
That's why I had to track him down. He was sort of, I had to get to him. All the therapists I interviewed, I found we're referencing his work. And one of the things he says is that all relationships deteriorate naturally. So if you begin a relationship, it will fall apart and come to an end unless you put conscious energy into maintaining it. And that's what people tend to not do. They tend to just let the relationship go on its own without putting energy. And then once it sort of ebbs, say, oh, I better get somebody else because this isn't working. And you just go through a cycle of the same thing over and over again. And that conscious energy is just mainly checking in with your partner emotionally. One of his main pieces of advice is that you need to regularly ask your partner how they're feeling.
Yeah.
And if you don't, it's going to deteriorate and it will end. But if you do that, you know, it's much harder today because we have these little units called iPhones or, you know, personal computers that we come home, we get on the iPhone, we get on the computer, we get on the TV, and we were facing this screen instead of facing our partner. And so what you need to do is you need to come home, put your phone on airplane mode, turn off the TV, and spend 15 to 20 minutes and say, honey, how was your day? How are you feeling? And then shut up and listen. And let them engage and download and express their feelings for about 15 to 20 minutes. It's this nutrient that human beings need. And without that, they're going to feel a deficiency, and eventually it's going to harm the relationship and it will come to an end. You probably, if you're with somebody now, you probably want to maintain the relationship. You probably want it to go on. So try this experiment. You've got nothing to lose. Take a week. And every night, consciously, shut off the phone, make eye contact, and say genuinely, how are you feeling? How was your day? And then listen. Don't interject. And I'm talking primarily to the masculine side of the brain. This is the masculine part of the brain has the hardest time with this, just shutting up. Don't offer suggestions. Don't try to fix anything. Don't offer any advice. Just express empathy. Say things like, oh, I'm so sorry that happened. Oh, that's wonderful. Tell me more. And that's it. And or as simple as, oh, that's all you need to do. You're demonstrating that you're engaged. You're hearing that person. You're seeing that person. And you're feeling what they're feeling. You're demonstrating that. And this connection will strengthen the bond. It'll make everything better. The sex will be better. It'll come back again. You're going to smile and laugh more. You're going to do more things together. That 15 to 20 minutes per night. And if you don't do it, what sets in is what they call habituation, where you take the partner for granted, and they're going to go away. If not physically, emotionally, and eventually it'll be untenable. There's a couple of things I learned by just doing a little research. And it's so simple. How hard is it to just say, how was your day? But we don't do it. So that's one of the major pieces of advice that I took away from that process of making the truth about marriage.
Yeah, and it's really important. If kids were taught what therapists call active listening, and, you know, I'm going to go on record, I'm not a big fan of psychotherapy. There you go, I've said it. I've seen too many people get into that authority relationship with somebody who is taking their money, and they're not really finding that much out. Along the way, often. Having said that, there are other people, you know, like, say, my friend Rachel Bernstein in LA, who I know does great work with people, so I'm not saying that there's no necessity for it, but I think often therapy is because you don't know how to talk to your partner.
Because you're not getting that nutrient from your partner, so you're paying a therapist to listen. So you're getting your nutrient from the therapist, you're paying them to give it to you instead of your partner giving it to you.
Yeah. And a part of that is what therapists call active listening, and it's so easy. You listen to what the person says, you pay full attention to what they're saying, and then you paraphrase it back in a simple way. It's important you don't just repeat back to them what they say. And we have this street epistemologists out there, and there are tens of thousands now who are saying, so what you believe is? Well, that's not active listening. Just you need to engage and respond. And by teaching kids this, and some of Sir Matthew Lipman's work, which goes back 30 or 40 years now, where rather than having teachers give you this information to memorize, they are facilitating your thinking about things. So there was a great documentary called Socrates for 6-Year-Olds about 30 years ago about his work. And you've got all these little six-year-olds sitting in a circle, and they're all 6 months behind, which at 6 years old is a long way behind. And you have a circle, and the facilitator says, well, why do we need a brain? And the first kid goes, I think we need a brain. Yes, because. And the next kid then, and they go around the circle, everybody gets to talk. The next kid says, either I agree or I disagree. And then what they think, if we didn't have a brain, we'd fall over. You know, something like that. And the job of the facilitator is not to interject, exactly as you say. Let these kids think. What they found was, in these kids and in 15-year-old latchkey kids in New Jersey who were in the school of last resort, you know, that was it if you failed in this one, they were all expected to go out and become hoes, pimps and drug dealers at the age of 16. But after 6 months of this, you know, once a week or something, these discussions, you could see the astonishing change in these young people. Every one of them went on to senior high because they'd connected finally. And I think, you know, the educational process is a process of how do we communicate with others? I'm a big fan of the work of Eric Fromm, which dates right back to the 1930s, where he wrote a book in the 50s called The Art of Loving, which sold about 2 million copies, but, you know, and is still selling. And he gives this analogy. He says, you want to be a painter, but you've decided that until you see the subject matter that will inspire you, you won't do anything about it. Because when you see that subject matter, you'll be able to paint it. Well, as a painter, I can say that's not actually true. And he says, it's the same with love. If you're just waiting for some object to bring you alive in this way, you will be disappointed. Love is something that you learn how to do. You learn, and I speak, you know, having survived two dreadful marriages, which is, you know, doubtless to some extent my fault. And you know, I have four kids and all of that. And I'm now in a fantastic relationship. You know, I'm incredibly lucky in that regard with somebody who similarly has been through very difficult relationships. But you work at it. One of the things that John Gottman talks about in his surprise, he set up a laboratory situation where he could observe couples and how they behave to one another. They'd be recorded without anybody intervening, without somebody coming and asking them a slew of questions or what have you. And he says that he expected that he'd just prove that all the touchy-feely ideas about counselling of the 60s were correct. And that's all you needed to do. You needed to be totally open with the other person. You needed to be nice and lovely all the time. But what he found was that the relationships that survived were the ones where there was conflict. But the conflict was not an attack of one person on the other. It was the concern that the other person was going to hurt themselves or they were going to get into trouble. It was an act of love. The aggression was to try and defend the other person. And that interchange, being able to sit for long enough, you know, taking five, as he says, when you get to the point where you do feel that you want to hit the other person, it's time to go for a walk or do something else. And as you say, negotiate a meeting. Don't ambush the person. Say, I'd like to talk about this. Don't work in the accusative. You know, telling somebody they're mumbling will get you a very different response to saying, I didn't hear what you said. You know, there's
just versus you. You see, you did it right there. So use the word I, not you.
Yeah.
It'll exactly put you on the right track by changing those pronouns.
Exactly. And to teach that to kids, you know, to forget about whether they know, you know, where Canada is or, you know, who Abraham Lincoln was, which, you know, may be relevant. You know, they may want to go to Canada and, you know, they may want to read about Abraham Lincoln. But to be able to not get into a fight with somebody, to be able to have a reasoned discussion about something and reach a conclusion where you feel happy and the other person feels happy. And this has come back to this idea of the power dynamic that we started with, to basically bring equality into the relationship so that, you know, for me in relationship, what's important, as I say, I'm in a wonderful relationship because I'm with somebody who's not identical to me. I'm with somebody who has different you have strengths that will cover my flaws, and we can work together well. So
right, the dating sites that try to put two people together that are identical are wrong. It's mismatching people. You don't want two identical people. You want someone who completes you, not duplicates you.
Yeah. Yeah, so true.
And you don't know that until you meet someone in person. It doesn't matter what it says on someone's dating profile. All that matters, they found in the research, is that do you kind of like how they look, and are they close? Mm. Close enough to meet? You don't know until you actually meet in person and you get a vibe, and vibe is pheromones, chemicals, and how they make you feel when you're together, whether that's what you call attraction.
Yeah. I mean, and you know, my relationship is fairly public because I have we put together a YouTube channel called Lyrical Wax.
I've seen it. Yes, of course.
And
you're a great co-hosting team.
Oh, thank you. How kind. I really appreciate that. But it means that because we both have the poetic disease and express ourselves in that way, which is no longer as shameful as it used to be. You know, I for many years have sort of, I would never tell anybody that. quite happy to talk about anything else, but don't admit you're a poet. It means that we both started writing about the relationship, and it gave us a way of, you know, putting that out in public. And of course, the curiosity is that she went onto a dating site, and I'd actually, because I'm really good at this kind of thing, I couldn't work out how to take my profile off it. So it was 5 years since I'd been on this site, and occasionally I'd get, you know, some picture of somebody, and I'd go and look at a profile and what have you. But in 5 years, I'd only actually responded to one email of that time, and I'd paid the £20 so I could do that, and she hadn't replied to me, so I was feeling, you know. And, you know, Pamela wrote to me, and I wrote back the free one-liner, you know, I don't have a subscription at the moment, but if I do, you know, when I do, you'll be the first person I contact. And she just wrote back and she said, well, I hope you do. I thought, I'll pay the £20. And it meant we had, you know, 3 weeks before we met. And then, of course, we had to meet at 6 feet apart wearing masks, you know, and that went on for another month or so. And it was very interesting because the chemistry is fantastic between us. You know, better than anything I've experienced in my 65 years now.
You can't change that. That's a roll of the dice. You're going to have chemistry with some people that's good and chemistry that's bad with others. And that's genetic and it's evolutionary. It's out of your control.
Yeah. And it's, you have to pay attention to it. You know, and if you're lucky, then you end up with somebody who has that. But from there, again, Aaron Beck, the founder of cognitive therapy, wrote a book called Love is Never Enough. I think the title pretty much explains what it's going to be about. It's meant to be about counselling marriages, and I think that Gottman's work is better. Though I think it's an excellent book about communication, because he talks about the expectations we have, the you know, that because this is what happened in my family and in my background, it'll be normal for you too. And you can find that actually their tribe don't do that at all. Then there's mind reading. You know, you're meant to know what I'm thinking. Well, oddly, this ability doesn't really exist. So you're learning how to communicate what you feel and what you want, and how to do that in a friendly, non-aggressive manner. The other end, and something that I've done more work with in the last few years, is what happens in authoritarian relationships where you have an abusive spouse or an abusive partner, which in 80% of cases will be an abusive man and a woman on the receiving end, and in 20% of cases around the other way around. That's about what it seems like. I actually don't have any statistics for gay relationships on this, which is curious, but I presume that, you know, it's going to be happening there too. And the signs of that and the way that somebody is drawn into that, the more I looked at that over the years, that, you know, I went, before we met, I was studying terrorism after studying cults for a long time. Then I studied gangs. I went to personal relationships, sociopaths, narcissists, people like this, just trying to understand as much as I could about this, and brought it together in a book called Opening Minds, which we're just about to re-release with another 60 or 70 pages as Opening Our Minds, but showing exactly the thing we're talking about, that the car salesman and the guy who's selling you paradise are using the same human psychology that's underneath all of this. And it is very, very possible to teach children intelligent disobedience, courageous followership, you know, that they, assertiveness, that they have a right to express themselves, rather than this fixation upon obedience in our society, which, you know, this kind of medieval notion of children being seen and not heard and having to put their hands up to do things and not being part of the discussion, not being taken on a gradient from total dependence at birth to independence and interdependence by the time they reach their majority at 18, or, you know, I think the Romans were probably right. They said it was at 32 you become an adult, you know. It's something like that. But that the schools are not there to actually get you to take responsibility, to know what a mortgage is or how to buy a car or how to have a successful marriage. And it's kind of going, well, yeah, you know, the Declaration of Independence and the history of the Revolutionary War is very interesting, but being able to live a happy life, being able to contribute in a social way is probably more useful, and obedience actually is no part of that, you know, yeah, unless you should, in the military.
You should always question everything. Don't take anything for granted that anyone tells you, yes, unless there's evidence. How do they support their claims? Mm. That comes back to the nature of existence. For me, was questioning what everyone had told me since birth about the afterlife and other belief systems. And I started to say, well, wait a minute, where's the proof of all of these claims that are really extreme? Mm. That we can become invisible? How do we become invisible? What's the mechanics for that? Or how are we power? What energy source do we have in the afterlife? And, you know, I approached from that direction, there's no answer. They don't have answers. You just have to have faith. Well, what does faith mean? What does that mean? What's the difference between faith and wishing? Is there any difference? And once I started going down that path, the only way to find a solution was for me was to talk to the experts. So I sought out an expert from every one of, or most of the major belief systems, wherever they were, went to the headquarters of wherever they came from, found a Buddhist, found a Jainist, found a Sikh, found an atheist, a scientist, Christians, and talked to them all and gave them all a chance to convince me. Mm-hmm. And then I cut it together, and you see the result of my journey trying to just get to the bottom of what should I believe and how should I live my life, because we all just want to be happier, right? Ultimately, it comes down to, I just want to be happier in my life. What do I have to do? And Julia Sweeney said to me, she's an actress, cinemanologist, comedian, she said that this idea that you can pursue happiness is a false idea. Happiness isn't a goal you can pursue. It's a side effect of having a purpose in your life. And so the real question should be, what is my purpose? And no one can give you a purpose. I mean, they can. You can accept someone. So your purpose is to be a manager at the bank. Your purpose is to be in Scientology. Whatever it is, you can swallow that whole. But you're better off giving yourself a purpose in life, and then pursuing it. And once you're pursuing your purpose, happiness comes naturally. Mm-hmm. And for most people, the default is to have a child, and that purpose in your life becomes raising this small version of yourself to become a better version than you are, hopefully. And so for 18 years, that becomes, or more, depending on how long it takes to kick them out of the basement, that becomes the focus and your purpose in life, and precludes sort of considering all these other things. But once they're gone, you're back to where you started with, well, wait, what is my purpose now? And a lot of people take up hobbies at that point, pottery or painting, writing poetry, whatever it is, because what they begin to realize, and it'd be nice if you knew it from the beginning, is that our purpose is to be creative.
Yes, absolutely.
In some way.
Absolutely.
And choose the way, writing, dancing, writing a business plan, if you're an architect, designing a house, plant a garden, that brings forth life and gives you great joy to see that life coming into being, the same way that raising a child does the same, gives you that joy. So just, if you want to be happier, the moral of the story that I discovered from making The Nature of Existence was, find a way to be creative daily. And if you have a job you hate, you especially need that outlet for a half an hour a day to write something or paint something or whatever it is you choose, pottery or flipping houses, you know, as a hobby, if interior design is your thing, whatever gives you joy to create. And then do it daily. If you're one of the smart / lucky ones and you've chosen or found a career that is the same as a hobby and gives you great joy, then you're doing all day long that thing that gives you satisfaction and happiness. And your life is experienced as much more fulfilled and happy. And, you know, like you're writing books and expressing poetry and you're finding ways to express yourself creatively and you're publishing and putting it out there to the social environment, to your group, so you can get feedback. And that's what you do. You create something, present it to your social group for feedback, and go on to the next thing. One of the great dangers of Facebook is that it seems like it's a source, a way to be creative. You can go up and express your thought of the day or tweet your thought, but then it's gone. And it doesn't give you the same satisfaction of actually spending the time creating something tangible, like a book, or something that remains and will forever be, this was created by this person. Whereas Facebook, it just vanishes. It's gone. People see it for 1 second, it's gone, and you don't get the satisfaction that you would get out of doing something in a more tactile way. So don't let Facebook eat up your creative energy. If you say, I can't write, I'm not a writer. Well, you just wrote 200 texts or tweets today that have now vanished and are meaningless. If you had spent that energy on something that's a little more permanent, you would have a much more deeper feeling of having expressed yourself than this. It's like eating candy versus eating a healthy meal. That, you know, Facebook is candy that's not good for you. Writing in a journal is healthy and is good for you.
Or doing YouTube videos, obviously.
Or making my documentaries for me. Yeah, exactly. Putting up a podcast, whatever it is. Pick your thing. And, you know, don't let it overwhelm you. You don't have to do it all in one day, just little bits at a time. You know, I'm writing on my second book right now as well, and it's going to come out in November, and it's taken me 2 years, and it's seemed overwhelming, but I just chip away at it a little bit all the time, and eventually, it's done. You know, and this one's about comedy. It's about editing comedy, and it's based on all my experiences working on TV shows and movies like The Office and Veep and Curb Your Enthusiasm, Who Is America, Borat, and dealing with all these really funny people. And so I sort of expressed, well, here's what I learned about comedy. And I interviewed all these people I worked with, from Sacha Baron Cohen to Julia Louis-Dreyfus and Larry David, and sort of gathered their comedic knowledge and coalesced it into this book. And so I will then offer that. That's my latest offering. But the process of creating it has been extraordinarily fulfilling. And I just took advantage of the environment I'm in, and this is what I could do. And so I didn't really know where it was going to lead when I started. I just started it. And if you're sitting at home thinking, I don't have access to Sacha Baron Cohen, I don't have any ideas, you have lots of ideas, and you have a pen and a paper, and you have a document on your computer. Just start writing whatever comes into your mind. That's like keeping a journal. You know, they call it the morning pages. If you wake up and write first thing in the morning, that's when your brain has just processed the most information, and it has the fewest filters, and you'd be surprised at what will start to come out. And you might, I bet you do have something to say, who's ever listening to this. I'm sure you do. I'm certain of it. You just have to express it, let it out, and maybe eventually you'll get it into a format that is polished enough that you can show it to people, see what they think. They might just be surprised and amazed at what came out of you, and it'll be very enjoyable to have gone through the process and gotten to that point, far more enjoyable than tweeting how much you hate this or whatever waste of time you just did on Facebook for the last 2 years.
Yeah, and I mean, a point that certainly that first hour of the day is a very important thing about writing. But many writers will also say, keep it to yourself until you've done something.
I'm going to write this book. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. You're dissipating the energy by telling everyone, just do it and show it to them when it's done.
Yeah. And get through your first draft before trying to polish anything or do anything. Get to the end of the process.
Yeah, I've heard it called the vomit draft. Just get it out.
Yeah.
Get it out. Worry about fixing it and cleaning it up later.
Yeah. I mean, if you're lucky, it'll be the projectile vomit draft and it'll come out very quickly.
Sometimes you'll be inspired and it will just seem to come out of nowhere. And you'll be like, I didn't know I had that in me. Once you unlock whatever it is, you know, writing a book is really, it's just, you're airing your grievances that you've accumulated in your life. Express all these things. You'll feel so much better for having done it.
And it can come out in different forms. I mean, Joseph Campbell famously said, follow your bliss, and gave the advice that you should spend 20 minutes of every day doing something you really want to do, whether it's putting stamps in your stamp collection or listening to Louis Armstrong's Hot Fives and Sevens, whatever it is that you want to do. And I think
that let me add a corollary to that. Hemingway said when he's blocked, he didn't know what to write, he would sit down and write the truest sentence he could write and then begin from there. It's about truth. Express the truth. Just write the truth.
Yeah.
Because comedy is just telling the truth. Mm. Comedians, their punchlines are just expressing the truth, which we are all working very hard to avoid. If you can write down those things, that the skeletons in the closet, the things you wouldn't tell your shrink, that's the writing I want to read. That's the successful movie or book, if you can express truth in some way. And that's what art is, right? It's expressing the inner truth, or the truth that you have seen in the world around you in some way.
Yeah, yeah. And, I mean, what you said about creativity, again, Joe Campbell, the president of the American Society for the Study of Religion, and himself an atheist as far as I can make out, so that's interesting. But he wrote The Masks of God, which is 400-500-page books, one about prehistoric religion, one about Eastern, one about Western religion. And he takes you the development of all these things. All fascinating. But the last book he called Creative Mythology. And in that he says, well, religion's done, basically. We need to access our own creativity, and that is what is sacred within us. And he uses, James Joyce, Thomas Mann, Picasso as examples, who are all horrible men, by the way. So, that's not necessarily an advert. But this idea that what we need to be in contact with is the uniqueness of ourselves, the uniqueness of our experience and how we express that, whether it's in basket weaving or cooking me nice gluten-free cakes, which I do recommend. Whatever it is, something that brings you joy, that brings you happiness, as you rightly point out, happiness is not a goal. Happiness is a byproduct of living a fulfilling life. Whereas Kandinsky said, you serve your inner necessity. You find out what it is. Now, for me, in dire and dreadful moments, and bearing in mind I was for 16 years harassed virtually on a daily basis by an organization with 40,000 members and $1 billion and no conscience whatsoever, that I found that what made my life satisfying, apart from painting and writing and playing the drums and singing and doing all kinds of things, writing poetry, was actually helping people. So I make this differentiation between pleasure, which we should all have, which is getting a thrill or what have you. That's great. We should look forward to that. We should build that into our day, that we're going to have that cup of cocoa or bar of chocolate or whatever terrible thing. We are going to take pleasure. But happiness, for me, derives from, I had a letter where somebody wrote to me and said, I met you 15 years ago. And you probably don't remember me. To my shame, I don't remember the woman at all. And she said, my life was a complete mess at that time. And we spent an afternoon together. And I'd like to tell you now, 15 years later, I'm happily married. I have children. And I have a career. And I attribute it to what happened on that afternoon. Now, wow. I was a catalyst for that person to do that work. No messianic message inside this at all. But that is something, it's solid. I can always go back to the times that has happened and, you know, somebody's felt that something I've said or done has allowed them to make the next step in their process, you know, in finding something.
Self-sacrifice. It works great in books and stories and movies. All your favorite heroes practice self-sacrifice. That's what the good guys do, the good gals. And it's what we do when we feel good, giving to charity. You don't give to charity. The reason we give to charity is because it makes us feel good in doing so. And we're designed to receive a burst of dopamine when we help others. And that's pro-social behavior that happens in any herd animal or species that lives in groups.
I think Jesus put it, the gift is to the giver. I think it was him who said that. And I know the Sufis, the Muslim Sufis, you know, that you're meant to thank the beggar for taking the money from you.
Look at Ebenezer Scrooge. He could have made the choice to keep his money, which is the safe conservative choice to protect his wealth until the end. And he would have been miserable, continued being miserable to the bitter end. But instead, when he passed through that decision point and had a reversal, and gave his money away and opened himself up to charity and helping others, he became a happy person and was transformed through that self-sacrifice. That's the lesson. It works in stories and it works in human beings. It works in your life. When you start to do things for others, the rewards you reap will increase the happiness in your life.
And at the other end, you have the condition of narcissism, which, as Eric Fromm pointed out, is not a condition of self-love, as Havelock Ellis and later Sigmund Freud put out. It's a condition of not being able to love. It's a condition of needing adulation and praise so that you can feel whole. And of course, it's the opposite end of feeling fulfilled and feeling satisfied, where not even thinking about that. I mean, when it's sometimes said that you have to love yourself before you can love other people. I don't know about that. I don't know about this concept of self-love. It seems a bit weird to me. But I do think you need to not dislike yourself, you know, and therefore, you know, be able to do things for other people and engage in relationship, which again brings us, you know, around the circle, that everything for a human being is relationship. Being excluded, being shunned, disconnected from, sent to Coventry. That's the marker of an authoritarian group when they do that to you. And as you said before, in a tribal society, that could well be the end of your life because you're now a rogue human being and you don't have the support of the group anymore. You'll find it probably impossible to survive. So being pro-social, being life-affirming, again, as Eric Fromm said, rather than being life-denying, it's... You know, it's an important. We're going to add this all together and we'll call it the way to happiness. You know, sign it, run up.
That's the perfect title for your episode. This is the happiness episode.
Excellent. This is great. I'm going to let you get on with your day. This has been fantastic. It's been such a pleasure to talk with you again.
And I'm back to work. I'll jump on my computer that you'll see behind me and begin editing season 11 of Curb Your Enthusiasm.
Fantastic.
I get to laugh my way through the day. I'm very lucky or blessed or whatever you want to call it, that my job is a hobby that I would do for free if they let me, but luckily they still pay me to do it, and I enjoy it and receive great happiness through my work and through my activities of the day, and my purpose is aligned with what I do to feel good. So I'm a lucky man.
Yeah, and I'm a lucky man being allowed to talk with you in this way.
And vice versa, and having known you now for 13 years and going on, I hope, another 13. So let's make this bond, continue to make it stronger as through every decade.
Yes, absolutely, in another 13 years. Well, hopefully in another few weeks, we'll come back and maybe talk again. And
happy to. Yeah, anytime, yeah. Of course.
Great. Fantastic. So I'm John Atack, my guest, Roger Nygaard.
You Thanks can so find me at my website, rogernygaard.com, where all my films are located. There's my shameless plug.
Well, and do, please go and do it. Nature of Existence is brilliant. It's a remarkable work. Suckers is a great thing, and I haven't watched the piece about marriage, and now I'm going to have to go and buy it. So what can I say? But fantastic.
You can find it on Amazon or wherever you're, or Vimeo. I've got it up on my, I've got a page on Vimeo where you can get it. So please do check it out and let me know what you think.
Yeah, I will do. We'll probably talk about that in a month's time or something right. like that. Great. Thank you so much, Roger.
Bye for now.
Hi, John here. Thanks for watching. We'd appreciate it very much if you would click like, as well as subscribe, and click the bell for notifications. Every dollar helps, and we welcome new patrons on Patreon. Or you can make a one-off payment with any currency through PayPal. Thanks so much.